Today, we'll be walking you through the Charter Body Composition Medical Results Sheet.
At the top of the results sheet, you'll see your name, ID, height, gender, and more. It's important to make sure that user data is input correctly and that you don't have the wrong person's results sheet in your hands. At the right of this section, you'll see your total body weight. Your body weight is made up of the five different compartments you see on the left. Let's start with body water. TBW on the results sheet means total body water, and that's what you get when you combine intracellular water, which is the water inside your cells, and extracellular water, which is the water outside your cells. Body water oftentimes correlates with muscle mass, as muscle is high in water content. The next compartment is protein. So when you add your body water and protein, you get soft lean mass, which is sometimes called lean body mass. Basically, you can think of it as the amount of muscle in your body. Next, we have minerals. Note that this is the weight of minerals in your body, most of which is contained in your bones. This is not the same as bone density. To get a bone density measurement, you need to get something like a DEXA scan. By adding minerals to soft lean mass, you get fat-free mass. As its name makes clear, fat-free mass is the weight of everything in the body except for fat. So if you add body fat mass to fat-free mass, you'll get total body weight. At the right-hand side, we provide reference ranges for the various compartments. But in general, we'd recommend using the other parts of the results sheet, as they're designed to be easier to understand. This section is fairly straightforward, but very useful. It looks at the amount of muscle and fat in your body and tells you if it's under, normal, or over for your height and gender based on the length of the black line and where it stops. The first line will have the same total body weight that you saw on the top right of the results sheet. Note that normal here is calculated based on body mass index. The second line is skeletal muscle mass, or SMM. The difference between skeletal muscle mass and soft lean mass from the section above is that skeletal muscle mass is the muscle that you use to move your body, and that can be actively developed through nutrition and training. Increasing skeletal muscle mass is actually a key part of weight loss, as it will also increase your basal metabolic rate, and you'll burn more calories each day. It's generally a good recommendation to try and increase your skeletal muscle mass into the over range, meaning that you have more muscle than the average person. The third line is body fat mass. Just like the lines above, this will tell you if the amount of body fat you have on your body is under, normal, or over. Note that the normal range is a bit wider than normal range for weight or muscle. We generally recommend keeping your body fat mass within normal range, as body fat that is both too low or too high can have negative effects on your long-term health.
Let's move to the obesity analysis section, which includes body mass index, percent body fat, waist hip ratio, and abdominal fat. Body mass index, or BMI, is one of the most common methods used to calculate obesity risk. It's commonly used because it's relatively easy to calculate. All you need is height and weight. The problem with BMI is that it doesn't distinguish between the source of weight, so two people of the same height and weight will be categorized as having the same risk level, even if one person is mostly muscle and the other person is mostly fat. Generally, we'd recommend using percent body fat to evaluate obesity instead. In this section, percent body fat is divided into under, normal, and over. Normal body fat percentage is defined here as between 10 and 20% for men, and between 18 and 28% for women. In this example, this man with 17.6% body fat is in the upper range of normal body fat. If your body fat is over normal, it's a good idea to try and reduce your body fat until it's within normal range to reduce health risks. However, it's important to note that the definition of normal body fat isn't necessarily suitable for all ages. What's normal for a 20-year-old might be rather unrealistic for an 80-year-old. To help provide more context to help you understand your body fat results, you can compare your body fat percentage with others of the same gender, age, and ethnicity in the body fat percentile section. The shaded area marks the 3rd and 97th percentile. So if your results fall outside this range, that's fairly uncommon. The white line is the 50th percentile, which is the most typical result. The next section, waist-hip ratio, is a well-established method for evaluating abdominal fat. If you have a higher waist-hip ratio, that would mean you have more fat around your waist. It's generally a good idea to try and keep your waist-hip ratio in normal range. That said, since the primary purpose of waist-hip ratio is to evaluate visceral fat, we recommend directly using the visceral fat area result further below. The last part of obesity analysis is abdominal fat, which tells you your visceral and subcutaneous fat area. Like percent body fat, it's used to help assess the level of risk based on how much body fat you have. How is it different from percent body fat then? Well, not all body fat is equal. Visceral fat, which is the body fat that surrounds your vital organs in the abdominal area, has a higher correlation with health risks than total body fat. A commonly used risk indicator is 100 centimeters squared. If your visceral fat area exceeds this level, it's a sign that you need to adjust your diet and activity level, even if your total body fat is within normal range. In comparison, subcutaneous fat has less of an influence on health, so it's more for reference only. Next is segmental analysis. In addition to whole body muscle and fat mass, this part further divides your body into 5 sections: right arm, right leg, and trunk. It'll tell you how much muscle and fat you have in those sections, and the location of the triangle tells you if the lean mass in those segments is under, normal, or over. This is very useful for designing a workout program. For example, if you observe that you have comparatively more muscle in your arms compared to your legs, you can focus your efforts on training your lower body. The same goes for if you have noticeable differences between the left and right side. There are 3 different colors, which can help you understand lean mass results. If your results are in the light blue area, that means muscle is low. If it's in the green area, that's normal. If it's in the dark blue area, then you have higher than normal muscle. A reference normal range can be found within the parentheses, and you can compare your results with normal range in this way as well. Bioelectrical impedance vector analysis, or BEVA for short, is of particular importance for patients with abnormal hydration. Typical BIA relies on standard body water proportion for calculation. But for subjects with abnormal body water, such as dialysis patients, measurement errors in predictive equations are much more common. Because BEVA uses direct measurements of reactants and resistance to evaluate hydration and cellular status, medical practitioners can conduct preliminary screening and track changes in body water, even for individuals with abnormal hydration, increasing BIA reliability in clinical use. What else is BEVA good for? It can help you evaluate health at a cellular level. Malnutrition is possible, even for obese subjects, but it can be difficult to determine using traditional body composition outputs, such as muscle and fat mass. Utilize BEVA to directly evaluate cellular health, making it possible to evaluate subjects regardless of body type. So, how does it work? Basically, BEVA compares the subject's measured resistance and reactance to healthy subjects of the same gender, age, and ethnicity. This makes it possible to track changes in cellular status and determine if the subject's results are noticeably abnormal. How do you interpret results? The 3 ellipses correspond to results for the comparison group. 95% of people's results fall within the outside ellipse, 75% within the second ellipse, and 50% within the innermost ellipse. In other words, the further out the measurement point, the more abnormal your results. observe if the measurement point changes over time to understand trends. The next section is also related to cellular quality. Face angle is typically only found on more advanced BIA scanners. You can think of this as the strength of your body's cells. Face angle decreases with illness and with age, and it's an important indicator of your overall health status. If your face angle gets lower and lower, that's a possible sign that your body isn't as healthy as it used to be. The position of the dot on the graph allows you to compare your results with others of the same age and gender to understand if your face angle is high or low.
This uses a combination of your muscle mass and cellular health to provide a calculation of your grip strength, or basically how much force you should be able to exert using your hands. To be clear, this is an estimation, not a measurement. You do not need to grip the handles tightly during your body scan. If you have access to a hand grip dynamometer, you can also compare your actual results with the calculated grip strength for further analysis. What does it mean if your actual grip strength is lower than the calculation? It means that you should have the potential in your body to reach that level of strength, but perhaps you're not using your body as effectively as you could. For example, most people have roughly the same amount of muscle in their left and right arms. But can you throw a baseball an equal distance? Theoretically, yes, but in practice, not necessarily, because it's not just about muscle, but your ability to use it. So don't worry if your actual grip strength is lower than the projected result. It just means that you have a realistic goal to work towards, based on analysis of your body. What does it mean if your actual grip strength is higher than the calculation? This is a good sign, showing that you're able to use your body's muscles effectively beyond the minimum level that should be possible based on cellular and muscle analysis.
The health score is calculated using a combination of all the different results on this report, including cellular health, muscle mass, body fat, and more. Generally speaking, you will score higher if you can keep your body fat within normal range, and will score lower if your body fat is too high. As mentioned earlier, intracellular water, ICW, plus extracellular water, ECW, equals total body water, TBW. The edema index is calculated by dividing ECW with TBW, and the normal range is between 0.36 to 0.39. If the edema index exceeds 0.39, that means ECW is too high, which is often caused by illnesses affecting body water, such as inflammation, kidney deficiency, or cardiac problems. And we would recommend getting a more detailed health check to confirm if something's wrong. Next, there are a few more advanced outputs that fewer people use but can be rather useful. First is basal metabolic rate, BMR. A common mistake made by people trying to lose body fat is to focus on eating as little food as possible, while mostly doing cardio, such as running or swimming in their workouts. This certainly can help you lose weight and body fat in the short term, but for effective long-term weight loss, strength training to build muscle mass is important, because muscle mass takes more calories to maintain each day. By building muscle mass and increasing your BMR, you'll find it easier to keep weight off, because your body burns more calories, even when you're not doing anything. Waist and arm circumference are calculated anthropometric results that are used for research predicting body measurements via BIA. Body cell mass has been hypothesized to be a potential tool for evaluation of nutritional status. Assessment of body cell mass is particularly important for elderly subjects because it decreases as part of the natural aging process. As a decrease in body cell mass is closely related to immobility, disease, and increased morbidity, an accurate assessment of body cell mass has high potential clinical relevance. Total body water and fat-free mass proportion is about 73% in most normal populations. Significant deviation could be a sign of abnormality, fat-free mass index and skeletal muscle index are used as ways to evaluate your muscle proportion, following a similar concept as BMI, using height to normalize mass. These are used most often as a way of sarcopenia evaluation. Fat mass index follows the same logic, except used for obesity evaluation. Lastly, we have impedance. This isn't really something you need to worry about, as it's part of the raw data the device uses to perform body composition calculations. Just remember that if you have questions about your results, make sure you have your impedance results available if something seems odd. We'll be talking more about how you can use these results, depending on if you're using your device for fitness, fat loss, or risk analysis in a separate video, so stay tuned.